time permits, I'll also go through some of the programs and the studies which we have done outside the compliance program, and then some conclusions. So just to put into context my presentation, I just want to talk about, you know, the environmental awareness which arose internationally. The relationship which exists between the environment and business is a complex one. However, the debate of the environmental issues is not a new one, but I think it's only relatively recently that the top management have been changing their attitudes and, more importantly, their actions to achieve environmental protection. You know, yesterday, for example, Judith Hackett from UKHSE highlighted that the safety issues in the UK were kind of come to fore in the 1830s, but it wasn't until 1974 with Health and Safety at Work Act that changed the game, you know, in terms of safety protection. But when you compare UK against the environment, it wasn't until 1990 that the Environmental Protection Act was introduced in the UK. So that just gives you a similar picture, you know, when you look around the world, environmental regulation is somewhat lagging behind health and safety. When you look at the environmental awareness, I think, 1960s, some of you may, here in the US, there was a book written by Rachel Carson, in which she highlighted, called Silent Springs, in which she highlighted the hazards of using pesticide DDT, in which she explored, one of the most important concepts that, actions of the humans, could potentially be disastrous unless we know, the environment we're dealing with. So if we don't know natural systems and we go on with developments, then there could be disastrous consequences. And in that case, you could eliminate species. And that book really was kind of the starting point of environmental, the environmentalism in the US. And at the same time, there was this issue of radioactive material strontium 90, which was found in mother's milk, which came from the nuclear testing of the energy sector. And some other books, One Earth and things like this. Prior to this, in the 60s, people were seeing businesses as something which is, driving for economic growth and, it gives us improved standards of living. As the 60s grew to, end, and then, business suddenly became, a villain, because people then started to say, well, if the business is causing environmental damage. 70s, 80s, we saw some recession, so the environment prominence was somewhat decreased, but this was a temporary issue. By mid-90s, became more aware of some issues such as climate change, ozone depletion, and then that again put the focus back on environmental issues. But it was mainly people then started to target the products rather than generally integrate environment or sustainable development as an issue. So things like aerosol, sprays with that CFCs, people are targeting end use to consumers as well as the producer of those aerosols. Then in the late 80s, we saw some really significant increase in environmental legislation, particularly in Europe. And by 1990s, there were something like 300 EU directives, relating to the environment, and that is still growing. So that just shows you the shift from 60s to 90s. Then the businesses try to react to this and then, how to, deal with these issues, and things like, management systems came into the fore, like EMAS, the European Management Order Scheme, 1993, and the ISO 14001 in 1996. So we can say by the end of 90s, people became more aware, that the need to actively manage or be proactive in environmental performance. And now the environment is seen in most companies, organizations as an essential part of management. So that just to give you, the background where it came from 60s to where we are now. Just going back to Barco, we are an integrated oil and gas company established in 1929. Our refinery was built in 1936, and some of those units are still operating. And that just gives you, an idea of the challenges which we have faced in trying to bring those, an older plant into compliance with regulations and best practice. Our facilities include, a refinery, we have a distribution facility, storage, service stations, and a shipment facility. Management of environment is an integral part of our operating and business philosophy. We have, OEMS and things like this. Environmental stewardship is an integral part of our management systems. market pressures. People, you know, are expecting you to give you better products. You know, we implemented one of the projects, which is the Roadster for Diesel project, you know, at $650 million. Although we didn't classify it as an environmental project, but it's driven by market pressure because our customers demand Roadster for Diesel. Similar thing going on with Roadster for Fuel Oil, where people, you know, there are regulations coming in where, you know, your fuel has to be Roadster. There are social pressures, you know, people are aware, the communities are aware, the NGOs. So all this is putting, you know, pressure on businesses to make sure that they protect the environment. Just recently, well, last year, 2014, there was a World Health Organization report which said, some of you are aware, that said there were 7 million deaths worldwide in 2012 which were related to air pollution. So, you know, that is 1 in 8 people who died in 2012 worldwide were because of air pollution. So that just, you know, gives you a perspective into to how important it is to reduce, you know, the air pollution. We can save millions of lives. That slide, I don't think you can read it, but my purpose was to show you, you know, this is relating to Montreal Protocol, I think most of you are aware, which is to reduce the, you know, ozone, you know, this ozone layer depletion. And it was 1970s that the awareness came to research that aerosols were causing problems. The legislation was introduced in 1987, so it took a long time from the awareness of the research to the introduction of the Montreal Protocol in 1987. Now the implementation to reduce the CFCs is going up to 2030. The CFCs, you know, are not going to be available in the market by 2030. Now the expectation here is that it will be 2065 when the ozone layer will be same as 2005. So the damage or the recovery will take 100 years almost from the date we know the problem. So some of these effects to recover can take you, you know, generations. Just going back to Bahrain, you know, as with other, you know, countries, Bahrain was a little bit, you know, 1996, UK 1990, you know, we had our first environmental regulation, which was the enabling, you know, act, we call it as such, as Amiri Decree 21, which then allows you to develop environmental legislations under this overall decree. And we have, you know, since then, you know, a number of legislation which has developed, you know, air, water, waste, chemicals, and so on, and there's more coming. You know, so we had to, in 1999 was the first time when the real standards in terms of addressing air, water issues were introduced, and the industry was given 3 years to comply those. Now, you know, imagine like 1936 refinery, you know, to comply with those regulations in 3 years was very difficult and challenging. So what we did, this case study, I'm just going to go back to the case study now, is to, you know, how we took the regulations in 1999 and had a compliance plan, and I'm going to touch upon some of those projects. Not specifically one, but a number of projects to address air, water, and land issues. So what we did was, you know, integrated our environmental management as part of a strategic plan. We have a strategic plan, so every year we have annual business planning, and within that strategic plan, the management of EHS is you know, must, is an integral part. So we look at, you know, the various drivers to improve our performance. These are the legal, financial, social, political, market, legislation, you know, all to drive EHS, and we consider, you know, where we are and where we want to be. So we set, the company sets a strategic direction 5 years, and then every year the businesses actually have their own strategic planning exercise in which EHS is an integral part. So the, you know, the divisions and so on set their own, you know, EHS objectives and targets, as well as us as the HSD department. And our approach was, you know, when we look at the compliance, we did a lot of studies to, you know, identify the gaps. We obviously know that we knew the legislation. We had orders done. We had some studies done, and then, you know, it's just basically a question of where we want to go in terms of compliance. And as a result, we came out. One of the things which we used was, you know, what were the challenges in actually coming up with a compliance plan? You know, historic practice is not always the best practices of standards. You know, we mentioned the soil groundwater contamination. You know, we used to dispose waste in various locations which were not lined, and then so on. We had issues when it came to temperature on the effluent. You know, that was an issue for us. It was very high salinity and high temperature. So to get the biological treatment to work, we had to do a lot of bench scale testing, pilot plants, and so on. There were no regulations in Bahrain before 1996 or really 1999. So we had to, you know, look at our strategic projects as well, which were, you know, investment related, and get the balance between environmental projects and, you know, investment. You know, the very first day when, you know, I asked the question, you know, he is somewhat lagging, and there was someone said there is no return of investment on environmental projects. So maybe we had to strike that balance. You know, negotiation with regulators to times to do time scales. You know, we were expected to deliver compliance in 3 years, which clearly wasn't possible with the challenges, you know, we had from 1936 years, you know, old refinery. So we came up with a 10-year compliance program starting in year 2000, and we identified 9 projects, starting from unleaded gasoline, which, you know, we became unleaded back in 2000, so that was very easy or quicker to implement. Then we had a, you know, kerosene Merox, which was treating our kerosene with a batch process. We used to have that sulfide process, we switched to caustic. We had some effluent treatment in our storage facilities, which we sorted out. And then refining gas desulfurization, this is what I talked about. VOC emission controls, sewage treatment plant, waste. We built our, you know, waste treatment facility and storage facility, wastewater biological wastewater treatment, and a study to reduce our SCC particle emissions. So overall, our anticipated cost was more than $320 million, you know, starting from year 2000. Now, what I'll do is I'll touch upon, in the interest of time, I'm not going to go through all of these projects, but I'll just highlight the, you know, the major ones or the key ones in terms of their impact. You know, the first one is in terms of reducing the impact on air. We implemented the refinery gas desulfurization, where, you know, I mentioned to you that the legal limit was 600 ppm of H2S and gas. We designed the plant to have it less than 150 ppm. We reduced our sulfur dioxide emissions as a result of this project from, you know, 120 tons per day to less than 5 tons per day. That's 95% reduction. The project won some awards as well. So this was completed in 2008, commissioned in January 2009, at a cost of $151 million. As a purely environmental project with no return on investment as such in terms of financial gains, but the environmental benefits are huge. This shows you the slide, shows you the impact of the, you know, ambient air quality in terms of after the implementation. Bars there show you the SO2 concentrations at various locations surrounding the refinery prior to the RGDP, and the short ones here are showing you through modeling, of course, is the you know, ambient air quality after implementations. You can see the huge difference, you know, which was achieved in all these areas which are surrounding the refinery. The other project is the reduction of VOC emissions. We had originally 55 tanks, which were, you know, volatile products, and we started creating double seals with them. And now we recognize there's some more, you know, we added up to 70 tanks. And 4 of these are remaining. The problem is that we have to take them out of service, you know, because of some safety concerns. So we wait when the tank is out of service. And as a result of our increased reliability, inspection, and so on, now that you know, the time period between the service of TNIs is quite longer, so we take that opportunity every time, you know, it's out of service. So we have 4, and we hope that this will be done by 2017, these remaining 4, cost of $6 million. The Carbarox project, again, this was to treat our kerosene. We used to have a lead-based process where we used caustic. Now, cost us $29 million, and the implementation of wastewater, which I'll show you later, the caustic from here we used to actually mentioned, again, it's a huge challenge for us. The main challenge is because there are no downstream treatment facilities in Bahrain to deal with, and very little downstream facilities to treat the type of waste which we generate. It's basically sludges, oily sludges. So we ended up, and no disposal facilities which were, you know, class one type of landfill. So we ended up, you know, building a class one landfill designed to USFDA standards. And we also have a treatment facility which is stabilizing the leaded waste, because historically we used to have lead in the process, so we had that waste accumulated. So now we have waste stabilization unit. This project also won some award in the Offshore Arabia Conference. One of the challenges which we had in terms of waste is lack of obviously treatment facilities, regulations, you know, evolving. We still have a lot of legacy waste, you know, which is stored on various sites, you know, around the site, in the refinery, and other locations. One of the things when we installed the landfill, we didn't think that this waste will need treatment. For example, it's all lead in it. So that came as a, you know, after we built the landfill, so we realized that now we have to treat it. So we put the treatment facility, and now we're looking at thermal desorption, you know, in terms of what was mentioned earlier, in terms of removing the oil from the to make it more hazardous. Some of the other initiatives, about 2 minutes, so try and cover them. I just give you a flavor of the projects. But you know, we haven't stopped there. We have a lot of other projects and programs. Marine assessment we've been doing for the last 30 years, you know, around our coastal areas, and that has shown a steady decline in the hydrocarbons around our areas, primarily due to the improvement in effluent treatment systems that we have introduced. We also have done a quite extensive study on soil and groundwater, because as I said, our historic practices have not been always very good in terms of, you know, disposing waste, and we've done in various phases. We just completed phase 3. And that is going to give us an indication of where we need to focus our attention in terms of remediation. If we need to, or where we can put a barrier to, you know, it's a source pathway receptor linkage, and where we can actually, you know, try and prevent the contaminants migrating into a to receptor, which is mainly the marine environment. And we also have some other initiatives, like, you know, we have EHS Week, and the last one was in 2012, which attracted 25,000 people. So a lot of work goes into raising awareness for employees, their families, and contractors. And we do all sorts of programs. You know, it's a week, but you know, the activities longer, last much longer, you know, culminating in a day where, you know, the families and the contractors and their families come. That's kind of an awareness thing. We also introduced Green School Award Scheme, 2004-05, for secondary schools in Bahrain, to encourage children to come up with kind of projects so they start thinking about environment. So there's some really good projects which come out from secondary level students, you know, in terms of energy conservation, you know, recycling and so on. And that scheme is funded and run every year, and we give awards to them with a ceremony, you know, getting the ship education, and that's an award. I just wanted to just briefly mention to you about two of the, you know, we mentioned about climate change the other day, and, you know, interesting from Ibrahim Daib and David, the work the Bicarbon is doing. We are also focusing on renewable energy, and we've done two projects. One is the solar panel project, cost us $25 million, and we introduced, you know, we put 21,000 solar panels to generate 5 megawatts. And the electricity from some of these goes and feeds our wastewater treatment plant. So the whole of our wastewater treatment plant is running from this 5 megawatt, and the surplus is given to the national grid. So we hope this will come kind of, you know, come as a role model for solar power in the rest of the kingdom. You know, one of the largest, certainly in Bahrain, you know, 21,000 solar panels. We also have a you know, CO2 recovery project which we've done with a, you know, with a partner. So we're basically, you know, recovering about 200 metric tons of CO2 from our hydrogen plant, which is almost pure. And this company is actually using it in, I believe, as an industrial in the beverage sector. So we are actually not actually reducing the climate impact, as well as we can, you know, use this as a product. So it's a win-win solution for us and the contractor who has helped us to implement this project. Environmental island, you know, you couldn't think of any refinery, you could have a green island. this has to be integrated as part of the strategic business planning. So we continue to demonstrate our commitment to the protection of the environment. We have spent more than